In this week's space news, Space Machines Optimus Viper. Space Machines Company, or SMC for short, is an Australian space startup. They're working on satellites that can provide orbit-side assistance, as they call it. First responders that can monitor, assist, and protect space assets. As space becomes a future warfighting domain, a new class of satellites tasked with safeguarding assets is growing. Space Machines recently introduced its Optimus Viper inspection satellite. According to the company, it can inspect a satellite within 10 kilometers in under 24 hours. Space Machines is offering an inspection service charging $2 to $3 million per inspection in low Earth orbit, a fraction of the current costs, according to the company. Optimus Viper is a 200-kilo platform with autonomous capabilities. It can be configured for various mission roles, such as space domain awareness, precise orbital monitoring, and in the future, repairing, upgrading, and refueling roles. The company claims they can produce this satellite for one-tenth the traditional cost in Australia. This allows for distributed space security at scale. Billions of dollars of crucial infrastructure is located in space. Their first Optimus satellite was launched on a SpaceX Falcon 9 rocket in 2024. In 2026, Space Machines will be deploying this satellite platform in various missions to demonstrate its effectiveness. SMC recently completed development of the Centilla engine, the heart of Optimus Viper's rapid maneuverability. This metal 3D printed thruster delivers 50 newtons of thrust at an impressive 92% efficiency, surpassing the initial 90% target. Future iterations aim to approach near ideal efficiency. Rajat Kulthresher, co-founder and CEO of SMC, highlighted the engine's importance. "We've achieved faster progress than even our most optimistic schedules predicted. The engine has reached steady state conditions and can run for extended periods, limited only by propellant supply from our tanks," unquote. The company opted for vertical integration for the engine since this is the crucial piece of technology for the company. The satellite is basically a high-performance engine with a payload on top. The propulsion team adopted a build-to-learn, learn-to-build approach, identifying and resolving issues rapidly through locating the testing and manufacturing facilities next to each other. Rajat went on to say, "When the team identified an issue during testing, they diagnosed it within 10 minutes and implemented solutions immediately. That responsiveness is impossible when working with external suppliers," unquote. With the engine complete, SMC is now integrating Centilla with flight-grade valves and a propellant management system for its debut on Optimus Viper. On to our second news story this week. Space startups looking to win commercial contracts for Mars. Earlier this month, Rocket Lab's CEO, Peter Beck, told investors about his interest in building a Mars Telecommunications Orbiter, or MTO for short. This is a spacecraft proposed in a policy bill which became law in July. The One Big Beautiful Bill allocated $700 million for a high-performance Mars Telecommunications Orbiter. This satellite would support future Mars missions, both crewed and robotic. The bill requires that funds for the MTO must go to a commercial company that received funding from NASA in the last 2 years for commercial designs for a Mars sample return mission. Proposals must deliver the orbiter by the end of 2028. 5 days after the bill passed, Blue Origin made a bid, saying it would adapt its Blue Ring spacecraft to serve as an MTO for NASA, which hasn't made a formal request yet. More companies made bids without any requirements from NASA being released. 8 companies received funding for the Mars sample return study last year. Those companies are Rocket Lab, Lockheed Martin, Blue Origin, Quantum Space, L3 Harris, Northrop Grumman, SpaceX, and Whiting Hill Aerospace. So far, 3 companies have made bids for the upcoming MTO contract: Rocket Lab, Lockheed Martin, and Blue Origin. Rocket Lab last year submitted a detailed proposal to NASA for the Mars sample return mission, making full use of its own technology, including the soon-to-fly Neutron vehicle. Blue Origin will turn their Blue Ring space tug into a deep space variant, capable of carrying a 1-ton payload to Mars orbit, more than enough to accommodate the necessary communications equipment. Lockheed Martin, with its extensive experience supporting Mars missions, also entered the race. A company spokesperson said, we are well positioned for this opportunity and are currently developing options to support the agency's needs for the next generation of Mars communication capabilities, unquote. Space startups, along with established aerospace companies, are eager for the commercial approach used by NASA for the Moon to extend to Mars. NASA in the past has built hardware in-house at huge expense. Hopefully, we will now see space startups get a chance to prove what they can do with faster development cycles and cheaper missions. It all depends on how much risk NASA is prepared to take. Of the four lunar landers NASA contracted under the Commercial Lunar Payload Services Initiative, only one, the Firefly Blue Ghost mission, was 100% successful. China has raced ahead in the exploration and surveying of the Moon with its Chang'e landers. Still, as I suggested in my recent space race video, private sector innovation will win out in the end. Given time, space startups' iterative approach to development will lead to cheaper and more reliable solutions for Moon and Mars operations. And on to our final story this week. Astrobotic's LunaGrid Lite advances towards lunar power milestone. Astrobotic is developing LunaGrid, the first ever commercial power supply for the lunar surface. This power grid supports lunar assets such as habitats, stationary lunar equipment or rovers through the lunar day or night, providing extra power to supply energy-hungry operations during the day or the power to survive the extreme cold during the lunar night. A group of vertical solar array towers will be networked together, providing an easily deployable and scalable commercial power service. Astrobotic aims to deploy their LunaGrid system as early as 2026. This lunar power utility service will complement the nuclear fission reactor the US intends to place on the lunar surface in 2030. As I stated in my Artemis base camp video recently, solar power is more than adequate to support a small base camp, at least initially. Freeing up the nuclear power plant to be located in a permanently shadowed region, like Shackleton Crater, close to lunar water ice deposits. Lunar grid service coverage can be increased over time by landing more solar vertical array towers and plugging them into the grid. Astrobotic recently reported that their Lunar Grid Lite mission has cleared critical design review, enabling the construction of flight hardware. The mission will deploy 500 meters of lightweight cable across the Moon and deliver 1 kilowatt of power using an Astrobotic Cube rover. Lunar Grid Lite serves as a precursor to the full-scale Lunar Grid network. Once deployed, the Lunar Grid network will support the Artemis base camp, scientific equipment, rovers and other infrastructure. The system serves both government and commercial users. John Thornton, CEO of Astrobotic, stated, LunaGrid is a core capability for sustainable lunar exploration. Power is the first enabler of science, mobility and habitation. LunaGrid Lite is the first step towards that vision, unquote. What are you most excited about in the space sector this week? Leave your thoughts and opinions in the comments section below. Thanks for watching. If you enjoyed this space news video, consider buying me a coffee to help fund more episodes like this. The link is in the description. Space News Live is on Saturday evening or Sunday morning, depending where you watch from. The live stream is a great way for you to share your thoughts and opinions on the videos I posted this week or on any space topic in general. I highlight the most thought-provoking comments on videos I've received, along with late-breaking space news and previews of upcoming content. If you've got the time, please tune in and say hi. Be sure to like and subscribe so you'll see our upcoming videos. We make videos every week covering the space industry, with an emphasis on the smaller space startups that aren't covered so well on other channels. See you soon.